Well, I hope you're not surprised. I didn't do the usual tease that I like to do the day before, but it's me, Dave LaMont, and you are going to have a nooner with me right now. And thank you very much for joining us. I'm very appreciative of your support I've received on the new page and on the old page, and thank you for that. Looking for a sponsor. Can't lie. That new page is starting to dig in a hole in my pocket. So if somebody would like to step up and sponsor the old show here, it would be very deeply appreciated. It's going to be me today. I'm going to try to line up a guest for Friday's Nooner. But let me talk. There's a couple of things that happened over the weekend that I thought were interesting. Well, one of them has become a mainstream story, and I'll start with that. The Deion Sanders story. If you're not familiar with it, Deion Sanders is now a head football coach at a historically black college and university, otherwise known from here on in as an HBCU, at Jackson State in Mississippi. Well, some schools are playing spring football, of which Jackson State is one of them, and they won their first game for Deion as a head coach. Convincingly, they took on a much weaker team, so you had to kind of figure they were going to win that game. And what happens at Deion's press conference is he starts to say that his wallet and phone and other things that were his were stolen from the locker room. I'm assuming this was a home game. In fact, it was a home game. And that becomes the big message that comes out of his press conference. Then the school announces, I forgot to mention, I'm the only one home right now, so animals could appear at any moment. It's my little grandson. So the school says, no, it was a misunderstanding. We found his stuff. All right, now you think to yourself, all right, these things happen, except that Deion's not giving this up, and he's saying that somebody in his staff saw someone breaking in and stealing his stuff. Now, I have absolutely no idea, nor do I really care all that much, if that part of the story is true. Here's what I don't like about all of this. Deion, which he used to do on the field, is pulling focus away from everything else and putting it on him. And if you have a complaint against Deion Sanders, you certainly can't complain about him as an athlete. He was an unbelievable football player, a true shutdown corner, and made it in the major leagues in baseball. Hard to do. Wasn't the greatest ball player of all time, but he made it, okay? And as he's an outsized personality doing commercials, he's on NFL Network, and now he's taking his crack at coaching. And here's the thing. I love the fact that he is at a level that needs his celebrity. But he's taken all of the attention that should go to his players, and at least for 24, 36 hours, has hijacked it onto him. And now we're going to need some kind of denouement on this, right? Eventually, we're going to have to find out, was somebody really stealing his stuff, and they caught this person, or not? Look, I have had the opportunity in my career, and I did it for about 3 years, and maybe even four, actually four, in college basketball games at these historically black colleges and universities, either from a studio perspective, or I would be on campus at the different arenas. Yeah, I knew this was going to happen. So just live with it, folks. It's going to be part of the show today. I didn't have time to lock up the cats. And these are schools that are fine universities, but their athletic departments do not have a lot of money. They don't. You know, this isn't Duke, where you have to have like a thumbprint to get in the locker room. This isn't some place where, you know, you have the fanciest football facilities and 60,000 square foot weight rooms and things like that. So when you get a Deion Sanders, and if he can win at Jackson State, maybe he'll bring dollars in. Maybe he's even put some of his own money into the program. I don't know. And maybe it will help other HBCUs get more attention. Maybe get other well-known former players, either basketball or football, to bring in their name value, more attention, and therefore more money. I remember doing a game, gosh, this was many years ago, at Grambling. Here I am, you know, the home of Eddie Robinson, the Eddie Robinson Award named after this great man, one of the greatest, not just college coaches, football coaches, but college coaches of all time, a truly influential figure. And I'm like, this ought to be really cool. And I didn't really realize what I was walking into. This is about 2008. And the stadium wasn't very nice. the facilities, the carpet was worn out, the desks were looked like, you know, they were from a elementary school sale. And it sort of dawned on me that these schools just don't have the budgets. And I can tell you that we did a basketball game, 2018 season, I think, at Arkansas Pine Bluff. And we almost didn't get on the air because the school balked against the idea of us building a camera stand in their new bleachers. It was almost like the people who put, the old people used to put plastic on their couch. So you wouldn't sit on the couch, you'd sit on the plastic. Now, we finally persuaded them that if you'd like to have your game on ESPNU to a worldwide audience, you better let us build a camera stand, which we did. But they were worried about having to spend extra money after already spending money. That's the problem with these schools. So they need the money. They need the support. That's why it's encouraging when you see a Steph Curry donate up to the Howard University golf program, or when Howard, which is a DC school, was able to get a hugely important recruit, a big seven-footer, and maybe these HBCUs will get more of these athletes that bring, again, more attention. And more attention, maybe more boosters or more businesses will look at this and, hey, you know what? Instead of donating money to, you know, big university A, how about I help out this HBCU and they could use that 50,000, that 10,000, that 15,000 more than these other schools could. So that's the only thing that bothers me. If Deion's stuff got ripped off, then that's not cool. And he also claims he had been burglarized once before, not at a stadium, obviously, but somewhere else in Jackson. So whether they have a problem there, I don't know. I'm not there. But my whole point is, let's get the attention on the athletes, and then Deion can draw the attention to himself if they're winning. Hey, they can go 7-0. That'd be great. And again, I would love to see other prominent athletes take that step and help out these schools. Jerry Rice, Mississippi Valley State. Doug Williams at Grambling has done, I think at one time he was their athletic director. You know, the history of the American Football League is loaded with men who came from these HBCUs when the NFL wasn't giving them a chance. Loaded. Some of the best football players of all time have come out of these schools. It's not happening that way anymore because, you know, more integration and more glamour and more television time and more this and more that. That's why a Deion Sanders could be so incredibly valuable to getting prestigious young men to go to these HBCUs, raise the profile. It would be great. And the same with basketball. So let's hope. But what a weird story to have to talk about. Instead of just saying, hey, good for Prime, he's a winner. And look, I know his Prime Academy thing in Dallas didn't go well. Say the least, it didn't go well. So we'll see what happens with all of that. But I guess we're going to find out one way or the other whether he truly got ripped off or whether this is some figment of his imagination. So we'll find out. Another thing that's come up, and it just won't die, and it won't die until something finally happens. They brought another column to Dave Hyde, who was on the show a couple of weeks ago. I asked Donovan Campbell the other day, the whole Tua, Watson, what are we going to do thing? And Dave Hyde writes in his Hyde 10 at SunSentinel.com that you got to trade for Watson if Houston is dumb enough to trade him. And, you know, it's just when you thought it was safe to not talk about this anymore, you kind of have to talk about it anymore. There's pictures on Twitter over the weekend of Tua working out hard, and somebody put right next to it a picture of Justin Herbert swinging a golf club. Well, this is what Herbert's doing this offseason. Look what Tua's doing. By the way, Herbert looks like he's got a nice backswing. I didn't see the follow-through, but, you know, that athletic deep backswing, you can go way back. I can't do that, man. I never could when I was young. Yeah, I could when I was young. But to me, that's a BS picture. The point is, this isn't going to die. Pro Football Talk reported that the Dolphins are interested. Well, yeah, of course they're interested. Who the hell isn't interested? The Bears ought to be interested. Washington ought to be interested. The Jets ought to be interested. There's a ton of teams. New England. There's a million teams that ought to be interested in a talent like Deshaun Watson. So you know who else should be interested? The Texans. So I don't know if they're going to trade him. And I don't know if you're the Dolphins if you give up everything and Xavier Howard. Don't know. But it just won't go away. But yes, of course you try if you're the Dolphins. And I'm looking up a story, so forgive me if I take my eyes off the camera just a second. But there's a story that I just read today that was just a touch disturbing about Howard that I think needs to be looked at. And I wanted to bring it up to you guys as well. So forgive the complete lack of professionalism. But what do you offer? Do you break up all of this? Do you break up every effort that you've made with Tua? You've brought in these coaches that worked with him. You've brought in all of this other stuff. Are you really going to just go toss it? After saying publicly that you were all in. I would. I would. You've got to at least talk about it. Okay? You've got to at least talk about it. Because if you don't, then you're not doing anything right. All right? Now, I mentioned Xavien Howard. Pro Football Talk and the Miami Herald have been reporting today about Xavien Howard, the Dolphins defensive back, who's a fabulous football player. And I'm going to read, Mike Florio wrote this piece, so I'm going to quote from it. The police had not been able to speak to Damian Howard. There was apparently a shooting at the Georgia home of an agent, Demarius Bilbo. It was first reported by Pro Football Talk over the weekend. Police have asked Howard to talk several times. He's not doing so. The latest request made in the last few weeks. His attorney is saying Howard's had nothing to do with this. So this might be a complete bunch of garbage, non-story. But some people have been interviewed. Howard's first excuse for turning down an interview last year was that he had COVID. Now, there's a couple people who apparently called this man who was shot. The other thing is that if Howard can plead the fifth, but he can't do it with the NFL. So if the NFL is really, really interested, and this shooting happened last year in June, somebody fired shots in Dunwoody, Georgia, at the agent's home. The wife and their 12-year-old son present. It looks like the only thing that got shot was the house, thankfully. They don't know who did it, obviously. They have an additional name list, and Xavien Howard is on that list. His full name, by the way, Xavien Dwayne Howard Areola. That's his full name, and that's the name that's on the list. Doesn't accuse him of anything. The Dolphins aren't commenting. Howard's attorney has said, my guy's got nothing to do with this. But the NFL could actually, if they wanted to, call Howard up to New York, and he can't use the fifth in that situation. Whereas he could if he wanted to and if he needed to. But it's just messy. The way you read those stories and what I just looked at there and what I looked at earlier today leads me to believe that there's just right now some smoke, but not necessarily a fire. And if you've been around me when I'm trying to cook turkey burgers, there's a lot of smoke, but there is no fire, at least not yet. We've had one kitchen fire in this history's house already. I don't want another one. That's true, by the way. So Xavien Howard's name has also come up as potential trade bait with Houston, which I think would be cuckoo for cocoa nuts. That'd be nuts for Cocoa Puffs. That'd be crazy to trade him. Here you have the most important positions in the NFL kind of go this way. Quarterback, those who chase the quarterback, those who block for the quarterback, those who defend the receivers. So that puts them in the fourth most important group. Maybe, you know, offensive line, I got in there. That's third. So I wouldn't do that either. And I don't know if this is affecting Xavien Howard's status with the team or the NFL. You and I both know there's more to this that is still being kept under wraps. But as far as Howard's involvement at the moment, we don't have anything linking to him. So these stories are always weird to read because just putting it out there creates an impression. Did you hear about Xavier Howard? No. You know how that game, that what's the party game that you play that you start with one person and you say something to that person, and by the time it gets passed back to you, it's completely different? That happens with the media a lot. And, you know, I can tell you, when the pandemic first hit, this is a perfect example of that, how this goes. When things were really locked down hard early on, I'm out walking my dog. I run into a neighbor who's walking her dog. And she goes, did you hear that the grocery Publix is closing? Closing? Like we can't get food closing? For those who don't know, Publix is a grocery store in the Southeast and particularly in Florida. And I went, now my brain, luckily, as a semi-trained journalist or trained semi-journalist, thought there might be something wrong with that. And I go, you mean we can't get in there close? That's what I heard. So I had to go look it up. No, wasn't right. All they were doing was closing 2 hours earlier than they used to allow for restocking shelves. That's when we were having these huge runs on TP and paper towels and wipes and sanitizer and spray cleansers and all that. But that's an example of a story that got read wrong or said wrong and comes back to you and you hear it and hopefully your brain goes, like the really weird stuff, I have got to look it up myself. And maybe you should do that too, because thanks to Facebook, where we are now, and Twitter and some of these other places, sometimes you got to, I mean, I'll look at something, especially on Twitter, three or four times before I'm convinced it's true, if it seems too crazy. Is that true? Wait, only, and then of course you run into the websites that are BS websites that aren't accurate, and that goes to every spectrum. I'm not blaming one side or the other. And that happens in sports too. There are credible sports sites and there are sports sites that, you know, are not so credible. And they just throw it up there and you're swimming in goo to try to figure out what's the story there. So the Xavier Howard thing, I've got no more information. Deion Sanders, I don't have any more information. We're all going to have to wait. Hopefully Howard's not involved. Fortunately, it doesn't appear that anyone other than the house was injured, but that's still pretty scary to have somebody fire a shot or two into your dwelling. Michael Corleone didn't like it, and Godfather too, and neither would I or you. But it comes down to, I think you wade through some of the BS. Now, I'll grab this right now, and you know, you can go through and see what's trending and you know all of that stuff. And eventually, if you see enough of it, then you realize, okay, it's true. And there's nothing here that is so dramatic, you know, that it needs to be brought up. But you got to have your BS detectors on, probably thicker and fuller more than ever with the way things are going. I'm not saying that Pro Football Talk or the Herald is wrong. They're just reporting what they have. So it's not the Onion. And how do people get fooled by the Onion, you ask? Don't have the answer to that either. So just keep all of that in mind. One other thing, actually two other things. I haven't watched a lot of golf. I'm a Tiger guy, and hearing the Tiger is like, meh, for the Masters, that's bad. Now, you know me. I did three shows on the Masters last year. I won't be repeating that in April because I did three shows on it last year, but I'll certainly be talking about it. So I watched Riviera, the L.A., it used to be the Glen Campbell LA Open. Now it's the Genesis Invitational. It has nothing to do with Phil Collins, Tony Banks, and, oh, God, the guitar player, the skinny guy with the beard. And I'm blanking out, and that's terrible. Rutherford is his last name. Mike Rutherford. There we go. I knew I'd get it. And Tony Thompson is the other drummer. But now Phil's kid, if Genesis ever does get back together, which it appears they're going to do, Phil's kid, Nick, is going to be the drummer. And Phil, who's had back surgery, and who can barely walk, and I've seen the man in Miami Beach a few months ago. Well, God dang, more than a few months ago. It had to be 2019 now. like most rock stars, he's about this tall. And but he was having a hard time getting around. He had a cane, and he has to actually do his shows sitting on the stage in a chair because he can barely walk because he had back surgery from all the years of doing this. Most great drummers have bad backs. Don Henley, terrible back problems. That's another reason he gave up playing and singing, because it's very difficult on your back. What was I saying? Oh, yes. Don't you love when this happens? So we get to the first playoff hole. Tony Finau, or as my friend calls him, top five Tony. He's only won once, which I couldn't believe. This guy's so talented. He's won once. And Max Homa, who's won once, who's kind of an L.A. homeboy. They get to the first playoff hole, and Finau, it's a short par four. He knocks it pin high, but off the green, short-sighted. Homa yanks his drive left and is this close to a tree. Now, if I hit that shot, I'm now going to be this far from the tree. But Max can't do that sort of thing. Well, everybody on the planet figured he's buried dead. You by now know what happens. He hits this tremendous chip, pars the hole. Finau has a chance to win. Had no gas on the putt. The putt went whoop. And Homa wins on the next hole. After Homa had blown a putt that was about, right? About that long to win. The game screws with your head. But, and if you're Finau, how do you live that one down? I know. You're supposed to just forget about it and move on. Never mind about the $1.6 million you didn't win. I don't know if it's that easy. It wouldn't be that easy for me. Yeah, I know you're supposed to forget it. But seriously, Finau, what's his mood when he woke up today? I mean, it's 9:22 out there. He's awake. He probably didn't sleep unless he took a muscle relaxant with a shot of whiskey. Which works, by the way, I've been told. The other thing is, I want to send congratulations out to Kyle Troup for becoming a major champion on the Professional Bowlers Tour yesterday. And it was interesting to see that some people have considered Kyle almost a sideshow and not a serious bowler, which is absurd. He's 25, I believe. And if you're wondering, oh, wait a minute, do I know that guy? He's the guy with the fro and the picks and all that. If you saw the highlights back when ESPN had the rights, we had, you know, him doing a double pick after a big shot. And a lot of people, I guess, didn't take him as seriously. Well, they will now. Kyle's a hell of a guy and a damn good bowler. And he beat some very good bowlers yesterday to become a major champion. So salute to Kyle and salute to all who made the show. And we'll see what happens with the coming show this week. But I thought it was odd. And it was interesting because the PBA Tour obviously wants the attention of a personality like Kyle. And his father, Guppy Troup, was another guy who was a huge personality, loud clothes, just like Kyle. Kyle dresses loudly. He, when he is on TV, he blows the hair out, which he says takes 15, 20 minutes to just give it the full fro effect. Otherwise, it's flat and it's nothing remarkable about it. But, you know, he knows. And it's important for the tour to have people that will attract attention, people you want to watch on TV. It is still entertainment. Yes, it's a serious competition, but it's still entertainment. Right? So I'm amazed that people didn't, you know, looked at him more as an entertainer than a great bowler. So this is the single best way to shut everybody up. You go back to Andre Agassi in tennis, and I was not a fan. Until you find out later that he's really a very good guy and you know, not at all anything like the image he projected. But to me, he was just all phony baloney hair. He was hair with a tennis racket until he started winning big. And then you go, okay, I get it. Same thing with Kyle Troup in bowling. I expect he'll win more than one major before his career winds down, and he's got a long way to go, and he's healthy. So it's funny. We get hung up on the image, and we don't look past the image. And that cliche about you can't judge a book by its cover is very true. Certainly isn't Kyle's case, you know. Is he a fun-loving guy? Yeah. But is he serious about his job? Yeah. And I think this kind of thing will buoy his confidence and buoy his work ethic even more. And I think he's going to continue to have a super successful career. And I hope he doesn't lose that personality on the lanes, because the PBA needs that. You know, bowling took a big hit during the pandemic. Lost shows, lost tours. They're doing everything from Jupiter, Florida, which is an hour north of me. You know, trying to do the social, you know, just trying to live like everybody else is. So good for you, Kyle. Very proud of you. And here's to many, many more. And here's to more Nooners. I'll have one for you Friday. Thank you for putting up with the Rambling Ad Lib Edition featuring Clyde the Cat. And I'm stunned that my dog didn't bark or that the other cat didn't show up either. But thank you again very much. Sponsors, you out there? Let's chat. And we'll chat again on Friday. Thank you again so much. Appreciate it. Ronald, for your comments as well. You can always comment during the show through the Nooner page, and it'll pop up right here. So if you have any questions or anything you want to ask during a program, I'll certainly take a moment to do that. Might do a Q&A show one day just to see who shows up. I'll be there, and I'll be there Friday at 12 o'clock. That has been your Nooner. Thank you so much.